You're listening to Paint the Town podcast with your hosts. LA Street Art Gallery resident artist, teacher, and founder of LA Street Art Gallery, James Chen of
the Town Podcast, episode 78. How's it going, bro?
Good, man. Good. I'm recovering nicely from, you know, Memorial Day weekend.
What'd you do?
I went surfing yesterday.
Nice. The beaches are open now in OC.
I went to Manhattan Beach and just surfed. And it was actually kind of nice because, you know, there weren't a lot of people around. I got there early. I get there like dawn, do dawn patrol, get out there in the water before there's too many people out in the water surfing. And it was a little bit small, but it was some nice, clean waves. You know, some good good soul enriching time, man. Anytime I can get out in the water first thing in the morning, catch a few waves, man, just nice therapy, both body and mind. Puts me in a good state of mind the rest of the day.
Yeah, I don't know what it is to me too. I almost drowned when I was a kid. Actually, I don't know if I told you that story before. But the thing is, you know what? We'll get into that in another time. But what I'm saying is I actually don't like being in the water. But there's still, like, after being in quarantine for so long, there's this craving to, like, go near the water for some reason as a human.
Really?
You know what I mean?
You?
Yes. I think it's weird, man. Like, I went up
Let me know when you're ready. I want to head down to the beach with you. I want to see that happen. Like, maybe even get you out in the water.
Yeah, I went up to Santa Barbara on Friday before the rush, basically. You know, I went to school in Santa Barbara, basically, right?
Yeah.
And then, you know, it's kind of nice because everything's, like, it was open before everything was open down here. So I actually went to a restaurant and an outdoor, like, courtyard area. It wasn't near anybody, you know, tables really far apart. It felt so nice just to have a meal at a restaurant, man. Fucking weird.
Wow. you know. They are very brave of you. My wife's a little sketched, still a little bit sketched about that, which I just, you know, understandable. We got, you know, the twin 9-year-old here. And so we have to have like an extra level of concern because there were a few cases where it had children that developed these special symptoms from the COVID-19, which scared the shit out of us. So, but it's coming, man. You know, I'm really excited and a little bit nervous. Our guest today is an incredible person, man. Cheyanne Sauter. I don't know exactly how you pronounce the last name. Sauter. Man, she's one of the projects she's doing right now.
I like the name of the project.
What's that?
I like the name though. It's called Let's Paint the Town. No, I'm just saying it co-promotes our podcast, which is kind of
absolutely
awesome,
man.
You know what I mean? I think
it's almost like a sign that we need to come together and work on things.
Oh, no, definitely.
You know, now that we have the new spray paint line coming out, you know, we're getting closer and closer with that.
That's true.
She's going to be a good person to, you know, help put some of that paint to some real good use. She even mentioned in an email to me about her building, you know, needing a new paint job in 2021. So
can't wait, man. That'll be.
I'm pretty sure that by 2021, we'll have an actual, you know, product ready to go.
I think earlier than that, man. I mean, you know, shout out to You Killed Me First for helping us out with the logo.
Yeah, Sean, man,
we're still
great
working
job,
on it,
bro.
Man. We're still working on the finalizations, but. The aerosol spray paint line is coming, guys. And, you know, we're going to try to beat Montana. I'm going to stay right there. whichever one, you're talking about 94 or the gold
one. Well, it kind of helps when you supply part of the product that goes in their paint as well.
Well, you know what I mean? Look, at the end of the day, there's systems that make things happen. And, you know, we need to.
Well, you know what? I really like what we're going to do with the artists in the cans as well. You know, we're going to get some limited edition series of the can opportunities for different artists you know, to have their own colors with their own designs on the cans. Is that our guest?
Oh, yeah, it's our guest, man. I mean,
awesome,
you want me to let her in?
So stoked. Yeah, please, man. There she is.
Hi.
And we can hear you. Awesome. There's so many times when, first of all, welcome to the show. Thank you for being with us today. You look like you're outside. Where are you?
I am. Yeah, we took a weekend trip to the mountains to a family cabin. So we're still up here for another day or two.
Oh, no envy going on here.
You know.
Cheyanne, how do you pronounce your last name?
Sauter.
Sauter. Okay. Thanks so much for being here. Now, right off, are you aware that there's a graffiti artist or a graffiti writer, I don't know what he would call himself, that writes the name Sauter?
Yes, I am. I have been DMing, I've stalked him, I've posted his stuff, and I've like hashtagged every Sauter and tagged every Sauter I could find on Instagram, hoping that like he would see, and no, I'm not getting any love from him.
Oh, man. Well, I tell you what, that would be a great guy to have to work with some projects on. He's extremely talented, right?
Dude, he's talented. And then like his locations blow my mind.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
like he's hanging from freeway overpasses and ducking underneath and like it. Yeah, he's talented and daring and amazing.
Yeah, he's I would say probably one of the top of the line right now. You know what I mean? Like, and in other countries as well, like in China and like crazy spots in other countries as well.
Oh,
not just in LA. That's what blows my mind.
Wow. I think he's an LA native though. Cause he's been here since I was growing up.
Okay.
But I didn't.
I'm not knowledgeable about that. All I know is I got, crazy
I'm going to share
respect.
Some of his work real quick on the second screen. If you guys just take a look, this is Sauter.
What's up, Sauter? What's up? Sauter clan in the house.
Yeah. And I think his Instagram is, you actually have to be approved to go on his Instagram, but it's Sauteezy. Basically his name with a, you know, E-Z-Z-Y or E-Z-Y.
A quick search. Oh.
Yeah.
There it is. Yeah. Sauteezy. That's his Instagram. And
my boy Edgar are approved to see it. So we got to take a look at it some other time. But yeah, you guys share a similar name. Basically.
Yeah,
I'm awesome. James, by the way.
Hey guys, let me go get my headphones real quick.
Yeah, please do. No worries.
Cool. Thanks. Be nice.
Wow, man, look at the. Are those redwoods, I guess, in the background there?
Yeah, she seems like she's
up in the
from a nice location.
Dude, that's awesome.
I didn't play the.
That's funny that she has been kind of stalking Sauter. That was just going to be like an offshoot question, and not really expecting that much out of it, and you know that's awesome that she's into him like that. Definitely.
He and ADZ AIDS, those are my two favorite writers in LA.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Those are what crew I think is Sauter. I don't know if he's LODKOG or. Maybe a few of them. I don't know. He should be like, you know, have his choice of whatever. But anyway, enough of that. So you're an LA native. Already hugely jealous with that. But
where'd you grow up?
Yeah. What part of LA?
Yeah. So I grew up in San Gabriel Valley in Covina.
Too.
So SGV in the house. Yeah. What's up?
You know, I actually went to South Hills. I don't know if you know, we're on the border of Covina, right?
So that's where all the good drugs were. I came from Covina High School, and like we had like the shitty drugs, and then Northview had like the drugs. Like,
so you, I was like a little bit concerned at first. I was like, you know, this is my first time having a face to face. I don't know, like, I normally smoke weed on camera.
So I don't just, I mean, I do, but I don't like to do it on camera because I don't like to promote it so much. You know what I mean?
It's legal now.
But I don't mind, you know, James has his own thing going on.
No, but anyway.
And it's 11 a.m., James. Like, let's be cool, you know?
Hey, I'm a waker and baker, man. Okay, so I'm just saying. But anyways, SGV, I'm from Covina, West Covina, too. That's so awesome to have another SGV here in the house.
Yeah, yeah. It was an amazing place to grow up. And my husband's from Dayton, Ohio. And we see a lot of parallels in, like, how we grew up in small town or town.
How did you end up with a guy from Dayton, Ohio?
Oh, he got super lucky. So, yeah.
I agree.
He moved to San Francisco and then went to LA, and we actually met on Craigslist. I was living in a 5-bedroom house, and he like applied to live at our house. We had like a rotating room. So we put an ad on Craigslist. He came up to the house and we interviewed him, and he became my roommate. So for 8 months, he was just my roommate. And
I
then
totally
we
thought you were talking about Craigslist dating for a second.
Oh, right. I know. Like back in the day.
I was like, I didn't know anybody actually met off. But no, that's so cool. But he was so he was like a roommate that moved in. That's so cool.
Yeah, yeah.
Where are you shooting from right now? It's such a beautiful background.
Yeah, so I'm in Sugarloaf. So one of the benefits of growing up in Los Angeles is that in the 40s, my great-grandfather came up to Big Bear area. They bought a plot of land, and they built this cute little cabin. And I've been coming up here since I was a little girl. And every summer, we do a big project. And every winter, you know, we come up here and go skiing and snowboarding. There's always, like, little nooks and little repairs to do nonstop. I just did some landscaping yesterday, but it's an awesome, like, a little escape. And it's a super cool connection to my lineage, the Sauter family lineage, just to have this kind of little plot of land.
Oh,
so
yeah.
What share.
Oh, yes, please. Sweet. Oh, my God.
It's beautiful. If the audience, if you're just listening to the audio, we're looking at a nice,
No envy at all.
In the background, we have some beautiful trees. And like I said, it just looks like a set out of a movie or something.
My dad and I could build that house. I mean, that looks like something my dad and I could build. And wow, what a beautiful surrounding. That's awesome. But you know what? Totally deserved. Totally
deserved.
What's
your family's ethnic heritage?
So this side of the family is Creole, French, and Mexican.
Cool.
And when they moved to Los Angeles, they worked in like the steel mills in off the 710 freeway. Mm-hmm. And Big Bear was like the place you went, you know, for a vacation. So when they bought the plot of land in the 40s, they used to camp on it, from what I understand. And then they slowly would build the foundation, and then, you know, it just took years. But
back
we
when
have
people
photos
weren't
of my
afraid
DG
to go out there and really rough it, you know what I mean? Like, really, right.
Really, like, there was no, when I grew up here, there was no paved streets. You would ride your bicycle down the dirt road and risk your entire life, like your entire body. So they paved the roads in the early 90s, and it's
you
awesome
gotta
to
hope
happen.
You're a good child, so otherwise it's like, yeah, honey, go for a bike ride. Go for a nice long bike ride up that street up there, really far away. Yeah.
When did that change? When parents stopped letting parents, you know, I mean, I think it's when video games came along, man. Kids started staying inside, you know, and then kids stopped going outside and just coming back when the sun comes down or when the street lights turn on. You know what I mean? Because even when I was growing up, that was still like a thing. It's like, go play outside. I don't know where the hell you are. You know what I mean? But just come back in one piece when the street light comes on. You know what I mean? Like, but anyway.
Okay, so I'm curious. After you grew up in San Gabriel, where did you go from there? How did you transition from there into getting to LA?
It was a pretty easy transition. I grew up kind of coming to downtown LA throughout my life. My mom was a seamstress, so we would take the bus to Union Station and, you know, ride walk around Fashion District and stuff. So I always had an affinity for downtown and LA. And I think like every good transplant, if I can call myself that, I moved to North Hollywood and lived in a shitty apartment up there for a good year.
Major dues.
Right? Yep. Off of Morrison Street next to, what was that sex shop? Oh, Les Sex Shop A on Lancashire. I'm kidding. yeah, exactly. And then became a live-in nanny for some people off of Mulholland who are still good friends of mine, and went to Mount St. Mary's University up in the Brentwood Hills. So just kind of inched my way west, but never fully lived in the west. Like west of the 405 was kind of a misnomer for me.
You're always like a county though, basically, right?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Go North Hollywood, man. That's like a lot big of urban change compared to like suburbia in Covina. You know what I mean? So like, did you like that better, or was it more your flavor, or is the suburbs kind of like more your thing?
Oof, that one's hard. So I love community. I love that connection to people, and I love being able to see the sky. So even North Hollywood felt suburban-esque. There were parks and you could see the sky and everything. And the Arts District where Art Share lives, where its home is, I could see the sky there. So I've never been around huge towering buildings like that.
Sure.
So I think I am more of a suburban person than a city person.
Let's talk more about
Art. When did the art influence start coming into your life?
Yeah, so I had the very lucky pleasure of living at the Asbury, which is an apartment building near MacArthur Park. And that was like early 2000s. And so I met a couple of people that live there, Shell Hagen, Nick Cha Kim, and then Kimba Rogers was always around. And the four of us, out of like an outcropping of a lot of discussions with the community, started something called Gallery Row Organization. And that organization begot the Downtown Art Walk. So I was kind of entrenched in the art scene from its nation stage in early 2000, when there was really no reason or no culture to go to in downtown except for like the Taper or the Amundsen. We had noticed in that downtown area that it was a really cool core space. And it was specifically Spring and Main between 2nd and 9th. And we noticed that there were a lot of blighted buildings there. And so from a nonprofit standpoint, we would go to a lot of those business owners and say, hey, donate the space to us and we'll rent it out to a gallery space, or donate the window space and we'll put some sort of installation in it and create a walkable community. And so wasn't my idea, but I'm a very logical, systematic sort of person. So I've learned over the years. So anytime I try and leave the art scene and go, you know, gain skills somewhere else, I feel like I get pulled back, because I have the ability to talk to an artist, look at their idea and dissect it into tangible bite-sized steps that can then be actuated into something pretty cool.
Wow. So,
yeah.
All right, have you ever done artwork yourself?
No, I don't. I'm not patient enough.
That's so awesome! Oh my gosh, I love it. I wish we had more people like you. Usually, that, you know, someone like this has some kind of artistic background. They've done some artwork.
Did you grow up with art like that?
So they're trying to help themselves also to some degree. Is my point. Yeah. But to have someone like you that's just purely helping the arts and the artists. Just another level up of appreciation that I have for you. That's awesome.
Thank you. Thanks. I do, to James's point, my entire family, three of my sisters are extremely creative. One is a fine artist. Another creates play backdrops and scenes. And then another one is a school teacher, which it, I mean, her school,
you have to be creative.
Her classroom alone is
what
like,
what grade does she teach?
Fucking fairy tale. She's doing TK right now, and she's doing like story time with the kids on Zoom, and dresses up every day. And I mean, she's just they're amazing.
So you're like the business mind of the family, when the other three sisters were kind of like the creatives. And so are you the oldest? Just curious.
No, I'm number three of six in the family.
So you're one of the God.
Wow, did
your parents ever figure out what was causing the kid? I mean,
Trying to save the marriage, you know?
you have two sisters, or, and then do you have any?
Three sisters and two brothers.
Okay. A nice little even mix of both, basically. That's awesome. Yeah.
If you go to Covina High School and say, where are the Sauter kids? Some teachers are going to run. Like, we were for sure known as,
you
like,
know what? It's so funny because I think every single, well, not every single school. It's just like, I grew up with some of my closest friends. They have like a huge family. Actually, they used to be Mormon. That's why they have like a big family. You know what I mean? But to me, I always like envied like families that had a lot of people. But, you know, because it's like you're never really bored. But I always hear from the people who are inside the family, it's like the worst, actually, because no one's actually getting enough attention and everybody's is that your case, or did you,
so no comment.
we're talking about art today. We're not talking about our
family. I'm not going on record with this shit. No,
back in the day, dude, a six child family was not a huge family, you know. That was kind of like a normal sized family. To only have like two or three kids, that was a small family a while back, you know what I mean? Because you had to have someone work for you, you had to have people take care of things. And, that's why there used to be a lot bigger families. But I just want to get to something right quick. I just realized that Cheyenne, she was the pioneering woman of the year.
Oh God!
For 2017.
Wow.
From City Hall, and what is that? The housing HCI DLA and Commission of the Status of Women. These, you know, City Hall, LA City Hall, the Commission of the Status of Women, and then I guess it's a housing and development, a big massive committee. Name this woman right here, pioneering woman of the year. I mean, wow. That's amazing. There you go. There's some.
There you go. Yeah, that was a pretty cool honor. That was pretty cool.
I mean, just curious, like, do they just like say, call you up one day, DM you one day and say, hey,
how'd we want to find out? Yeah.
I'm just curious, like, how did you earn that award? Because I'm so curious. The honor by the city of Los Angeles, you know what I mean? It's like, it must have been a big moment for you.
I mean, I feel like they were 10 years too late, but no, I'm kidding. I'm totally kidding. So when the city calls you, oftentimes they're looking for a favor, like, hey, we want you to be a part of this festival. Can you help funnel some money? Can you like take some money and like offset it and then pay the vendors? Or, hey, we're looking for, 20 restaurants. Can you name five? So they're always looking for like some
suggestion.
Support, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm always there to answer the phone and offer whatever I can. So when they called me with this, I was like, okay, cool. So and what? Like, okay, this award and what? What else do you need from me? So it didn't dawn on me that it was an honor until the morning of the ceremony, where I was called to go to City Hall during one of the open council meetings and be called up and have Jose Huizar speak on my behalf, and I received flowers and a certificate. Wow. So, and I posted something on my Instagram with like, one of my, profile pictures and just said, wow, what an honor. And the response that I got from the community was so massive that that's when I really felt like, oh, okay, this is a big deal. People, this matters to people. Of course, you know, for me, I come from a family of six, so staying humble is like an absolute requirement. So when I got my certificate, my name was misspelled and I never asked them to correct it. For 3 years, it's been sitting in my office, names misspelled. And it's always a reminder to, you know, appreciate what you get, but also remember you're human.
Wow, that's awesome.
I love that. You know, no, that's it's actually cooler that it's misspelled, in my opinion. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, like I said, they always ask you for favors and you're still not willing to just ask them for one thing. So I think that's really sweet, actually. Now, I'm just saying, like, for the art, though, I mean, like, I guess I don't know too much except for the late projects you've been doing called Let's Paint the Town, which I love the name, by the way, because it kind of shares a little.
I think you're destined
basically to, like, have this Zoom call. And, you know, we'd love to have you in the studio sometime, basically. But, like, yeah, tell us a little bit about the Let's Paint the Town project.
Yeah, and so sorry I stole a bit of your name.
We love it.
No, it was an omen.
It's a good name.
Sign that we need to be working together. Okay?
Yes, absolutely. And it's funny because we wanted to take out Let's as the project was going, but then I didn't want to fuck with your PTT at all. So we're
happy to share the name with you, first of all. You know, I mean, and also awesome. What I think is so cool is that it's the same artist that we've had on the interview, I mean, on our podcast, and now we have you on our podcast. So, yeah. Like, how it kind of feels like the teacher said, it was destined, you know what I mean? So,
totally.
The boarded up businesses and like and painting on them or something like that. Can you tell us a little bit?
Yeah, more? Yeah. So this really, you know, was a collaborative effort. Jeremy Novy called me and he had never met me. I had never met him. David Puck suggested that he call me.
Nice.
He was looking for a nonprofit to support this project because he was looking for donations. He felt that having a nonprofit attached to it would be a benefit to him. I don't think he realized how organized and coordinated I was. And I think he was super, super thrilled about it. And the phone call definitely, yeah, I think he definitely, it was magic for both of us because he'll text me images and text me emails and I'll catch everything and throw it in a spreadsheet and send it out. And he's like, whoa, how did you do that? And he's That's such awesome. A go-getter that I'm like, hey, slow down. I can't keep up with you. So it was really a match made in heaven between us. And then from my standpoint, being a platform for artists for so long, when the pandemic hit, we went straight into production. We started doing daily concerts on Zoom. We started doing prompts on our Instagram page for artists to create. We were just constantly trying to create new content that would stick and matter to the artists that we love. And when Jeremy called me, I had hit a moment. I remember I was sitting in my backyard on Saturday, just like really frustrated because we were asking artists to give and create, but we weren't able to pay them. And I knew I had to stop doing that. So we had stopped our home share concerts that week because I was like, I got to figure this out. And Jeremy called and said, let's raise money to pay artists. And I said, done. So it was like, it was kind of a perfect moment for both of us. And to raise
good timing.
Right. And to raise money in this time, it sucks. It sucks to raise money anytime. But the first 5 weeks, nobody, you couldn't ask anybody for money because they just didn't know. And they still don't know what the future holds. But to say, hey, guys, an artist is going to get paid X amount of dollars and it begets one board. That makes sense for people who have unemployment checks or who have, you know, are still working from home, that they can give $50 and know that they're giving like a portion, getting a portion of a board funded.
That's so cool. I mean, first of all, I love that. I feel like me and you were both like art patrons because we're not actually like artists ourselves really, but like, you know, we really kind of do our best to support the artist. And that's one of the things like being an outsider because I'm a DJ musician actually, and I kind of just, you know, I want to support my boy teacher basically. And then being an outsider looking at this whole, you know, how much they ask like artists to give. I mean, just they ask musicians to kind of do the same thing too. It, you know, you have to give up so much of your, you know, work and not get appreciated for it. It's like, if you work with a project for me, usually I'm like, I'm going to try to get, you can't get the artist at least like $100. You know what I mean? Things, right. Little things like that. It kind of, and then like, you know, I had some artists like pick up some work from my house this past weekend from an art show like a year ago. And they were just happy that I didn't charge them for warehousing their art. You know what I mean? And I was like,
yeah,
I would never do
that. They're so used to visual and performing artists are so used to digging into their own pockets to make their craft happen. And it's a mentality that I think this project helps to debunk and show that we need to, one, make sure that, like, I think we all know art is essential, right? Like, we've been watching Netflix and getting through this pandemic with music.
Cornerstone of society.
Absolutely. So we know that art is essential, but what we haven't connected as a society that artists are essential, that art doesn't get created without the artist. And art is seen as kind of an aftermath or an afterthought to decorate something versus an integral part of the infrastructure.
Yeah, totally. I love how you put that because it's so funny. I mean, I don't know, maybe it's a US thing, but I feel like in Europe, they kind of appreciate artists a little bit more. Sometimes, like, if there's an artist that's gonna perform or, you know, do something, like, everybody kind of, like, is very admiring the artists in Europe, in my opinion. You know, I'm over here, it's like, the artist gotta really, like, hey, offer the venue owner favors in order to get their art shown a lot of times.
And if you look between Los Angeles and New York, the difference is crazy. Oh, yeah. So the minute the pandemic hit, like, New York funding, you know, infrastructures were giving grants away. The Rockefeller, the, like, all of that old money that's sitting there in New York, they were giving to artists, like, straight $500, $5,000 relief grants. Los Angeles still hasn't figured it out. Literally, the Getty Foundation is the only $10 million grant that we've been offered here to arts organizations. In New York, there are several.
Wow. So, there's so much money out here. That's crazy.
So much money out here. And I won't say their name, but one of the biggest funders of nonprofits usually gives art chair around $20,000 a year. They told me week two of the pandemic that we would not be getting the funding, that they had to restructure because their endowment was in jeopardy. And I was like, seriously, your endowment's in jeopardy?
Like, yeah, and art's the first thing to go, you know?
Thank you.
Yeah.
So
that's sad.
It's extremely frustrating, and agree with you that I don't think the U.S. puts enough value in the art.
Can you tell us a little bit more about, like, how ArtShare as an organization got started? Because I'm really curious. I mean, to be honest, I'm very, like, wowed by this whole conversation right now. Because when I started LA Street Art Gallery in 2011, basically, I mean, our idea was to kind of press these same values that you're kind of sharing with everybody, you know. And what we want to do is bring the art to the people too. Basically do the projects that you're actually realizing, you know? So I love it that we're actually, like, working
already
together.
Already done.
Right now. How did ArtShare LA get started?
Yeah, it's kind of a cool past. And there's some lore around how we acquired the building, but the founder, Chip Hunter, came across a little bit of money and maybe a lawsuit with the city and maybe some, you know, weird filings of paperwork, but we came to own the building at 4th and Hewitt in the Arts District 22 years ago. And the building was immediately in the first year and a half of us acquiring it. So Chip bought it and then donated it to ArtShare, the entity. And then the first year we reached out to the housing department and asked them for a large sum of money to rebuild the structure so that the second floor could be housing, low-income housing for artists, and the first floor could be repurposed as a venue or a space for art to be created. That loan still is attached to the building and will be for 55 years. It's a part of the deed and the structuring of how, sorry, boring loan.
No. I'm actually pulling, if you're looking at my facial expression, I'm actually pulling up that picture of Art Share LA. If you're watching the, if you're just listening to the audio, you can check our YouTube on youtube.com/LA Street Art Gallery and watch this video. Basically, it's a really cool building, pretty much right in heart of the arts district, right? And it seems like you guys have a redesign it every so often, right? Basically, is this the building right here?
Yeah. So when this is the building, So the second floor, you see all those windows. Each one of those is an apartment.
Wow.
There are, I think, 18 outside facing and a couple more internally facing. Fully vacant. I'm sorry, fully leased up. We have a list of about my dog is barking.
That's okay.
There are squirrels up here, man. He wants them.
No worries.
My husband's coming to get him. Mr. Dayton's coming to get him.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Kev. So the 30 apartments are essentially for artists who consider themselves low income. They have to qualify per the county's regulation. But that whole structure in that second floor is what helps to support the building. So what we get from rent supports the management company, supports any fixes that the building might need and that sort of thing. And then the bottom floor, the first floor, is 14,000 square feet of space, and it's divided up into several different rooms that support arts. So we have two gallery spaces, three classroom spaces, some art studio space that we rent out on a monthly, and then a beautiful theater space. So so in that building, it's like the building is the mission and the building is the house. And so out of that has spawned all of these ideas. So the gallery space has created the whole visual arts department, which we support. I think it's like 600 artists. We hang them either on the space inside of Art Share or out in the community.
Wow.
I don't even know the number of pieces that we hang every year. Then our performance space supports all kinds of music and performance. And we have, 300 shows annually. So we usually are open Tuesday through Sunday with some performance happening in the theater.
Wow. Okay.
So that building is, wow, is Art Share. It is the mission. It is the home.
Is there an emphasis on visual arts, or is there, I'm just saying, for your guys' project, or like what, I mean, because you mentioned there's also music and other types, theater basically too, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is. So it's really hard to kind of share on social what Art Share does in its full scope, because it does so much. And so we tend to really focus on the visual,
sure,
arts department on our social, because it's much more visual. But we do have a lot of performances that happen in our theater. None of them, except for I think 12 a year, are produced by us. So we're nothing more than a platform for artists to create. So for us to promote a show that's coming this Wednesday night and we get everyone to come to the show, it might not be the greatest thing. So for quality control, it's become a decision of our social media committee to just focus on the visual art stuff when it comes to that.
But
we do like showing like live videos of what happens on our stage when it did happen.
Now, I got to imagine you've got, I guess, how many did you say, 30 artists that are living in those apartments? I got to imagine there's been times where maybe they haven't gotten along, or there's been some beefs or problems with tenants?
No, utopia.
Or have they all managed to get along well?
It's interesting because as you know, artists tend to be introverted. And as many times as I try to create community up there and get them to come to the common area or use space that we're providing for them, they tend to keep to themselves, and home is their sanctuary. So they stay behind their little four, you know, their four walls. But they do share bathrooms, some of them. They have a shared bathroom for two apartments. So that does cause some problems. And in the past, we've had pretty bad management companies. Since we're such a small number of apartments, it's hard to manage us because we're not boutique 8 and we're not 150. So for a property owner, you know, we're a small portfolio, but I require a lot of attention. So that has caused some friction in the past. So.
Yeah.
But if you managed to get it worked out to where it's sustainable?
It is. I mean, the building is dilapidated. The building's like 100 and something years old. And so there's always some fixes that need to be done. The roof needs to be completely overhauled and fixed. You know, there's just always some stuff.
Oh, believe me, I know. My wife and I flip houses. And I don't care how big the house is. It's always at least a couple projects that need to be done. And so with a building like that, I'm sure, you know, you got to have some, you know, continual maintenance and everything. But, you know, one would hope that with what is done there and what that helps to create, that we'll be able to find some funding somewhere along the way to help do whatever needs to be done when it needs to be done. You have all different kinds of artists that are living there, working with all different types of art mediums as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. The tenants are an autonomous group, really. If they reach out and they want to be a part of programs, we definitely connect them through what's happening downstairs. But the upstairs is really, they're just so diverse in their needs and their practice that we, you know, support them if they reach out, but they tend to be quite autonomous up there.
Yeah, I've actually been to the building before. I had an event there, I think it was maybe a couple of years ago, and I thought it was a great space to have an event, you know, it's the location and everything, the parking right across the street, and I didn't even know about the second floor.
Yeah,
I didn't know that those were, you know, artists' apartments up there or anything like that. So that's pretty damn cool.
No, it's extremely hard to share like what we do. If you're there for a you know, jazz performance, you don't see the art. If you're there for a gallery opening, you don't see the art studios. It's so sectioned off, and that's good and bad.
Well, I think there's ways of maybe working with that, but I have a question for you. I worked on a project many years ago that developed into actually kind of started in the Pentagon. And the idea was to just sit there and work on a painting and from like start to finish. Mm-hmm. And it got an amazing response. I was actually the first artist ever allowed to work on a painting in the corridors of the Pentagon. I was between corridors 1 and 2 on the second floor, but right next to the A-ring. And this was back in 2004. And the first time I was there for 2 weeks, from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. I started with a blank canvas, little sketch on it. And people would come by, and I actually had some other paintings set up that is the reason why I ended up there. That's a whole nother story. Wow. But people came by and they're like, well, you know, are you selling these paintings? What's going on? I'm like, I just want to give you guys something else to look at, you know? And they're like, are you going to be working on this later? I'm like, I'm going to be here for 2 weeks until this thing is done. And so by the second day, people were bringing me coffee and donuts, offering to buy me lunch and everything. And so that basically developed into going to military bases, you know, because as a Pentagon, they almost sent me over to Iraq to a Marine base, as a matter of fact, one time. Wow. And so from that, it expanded to going to like police departments and then like courthouse complex, hospital. And so basically I realized that I was starting to focus on places where people serve the community. And I was bringing art to them and letting them see the development of it, watching them, let them watch it happen. And that seemed to draw much more interest into what I was doing. And so what I'm wondering is, you know, it's not for all artists what I did. You know, you got to be good with having people around you and everything, but I got to think that your organization would possibly know of a few artists that would want to do something like this. And it basically makes art into a community service, as well as elevates the artists. I mean, when I'm, you know, working around some policemen, you know, who are willing to give their life to serve the community, it makes me want to, you know, focus more and I get more work done. So that's one of the ideas I wanted to talk to you about and see if we can develop that somewhere down the line.
Yeah, how can people, if they want to work with ArtShare, like, you know, I'm saying, like, what is kind of like the scope of what you guys do? Because from what I understand just from talking to you right now is that you guys are a nonprofit that kind of supports the arts, basically. I mean, you guys are the, you get connections to fund projects, basically, mostly in the visual arts, but basically mainly supporting this piece of real estate called ArtShare LA, this building, basically, right?
Yeah.
Would they just submit their portfolio to you, or what's the best way to get in touch with you to do that?
Yeah, it's really interesting because I think for me what ArtShare needs to become and needs to be is almost like a union for artists. So we're supporting artists as they're beginning their career and trying to figure out if it could take off. They come to us for resources, they come to us for opportunities, and we try to plug them and connect them. But I think our biggest pillar that we focus on is job connection and almost economic development. So people come to us a lot, or we do RFPs to find job opportunities, or find somebody who wants to commission a work, or somebody who wants to hire an artist, and finding that perfect artist and almost matching them. So creating that job portal,
opportunities for artists. I love that, basically.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things that me and Teach were discussing, like right before actually we got on this call, was I was saying that, you know, it's funny that if, because I mean, I mentioned I'm a musician, basically, and I'm noticing with a lot of artists, and even from my own music, it's like you literally have to put in 10 years of work before anybody to not notice you. You know what I mean? Right. And I think, like, so if you're out there, I mean, you're considering starting to be an artist or as your career, or a musician as your career, man. I mean, get ready for that. 10 years, man. 10
well, and all,
years. You know,
it sounds like you guys are a good organization that's going to help people figure out, you know, how much effort they really want to put into the art that they're doing. You know, because that's one of the questions that I have a lot of times when people send, you know, DM me on Instagram, you know, like, how much do you sell this for? How do you, you know, make money? And you know, how do you approach galleries and whatever? And it's like, you know, it's a complicated question.
Well,
you know,
and
it depends on what you want to do. Do you want to,
exactly,
you know, do you just want to put, do you want to decorate? Do you want to send a message? You know, do you want to make money? You know,
what's your goal?
They have unrealistic expectations. Yeah. You know, it's like, okay, what you're talking about, that's cool. You want to send a message and that's awesome. Just understand that you're not necessarily going to make money off of this unless people like the images that you're putting there. And there's no guarantee on that at all. So just understand that what you're getting yourself into, just understand what it is, so you're not setting yourself up. You know, because that's what breaks my heart, is when I see an artist that gets all worked up thinking that something's going to be awesome and amazing and everything, and then the heart gets broken because they set themselves up for it, you know? So I think that it's important to have organizations out there like that to help people to figure that out. That's pretty big.
John, what are your thoughts?
Why I'm not an artist is probably because I would give up before I began. Like, it's overwhelming. There's so many artists out there. There's so many galleries that are not taking portfolios. The system is set up for artists to fail in a sense. Yes. Yes. And it starts here and it pyramids up into such a small amount of people that actually make it. And yes. So, it is about helping an artist figure out, can you do something else and make money while still practicing your creativity?
Too, right?
And
right.
Exactly. And what is your definition?
Yeah, because some people, I find like a lot of people, they like literally they just want to be famous, actually. They you know what I mean? Like they're confused.
They want to be Banksy.
You
know? They do.
They want to do Shepherd Fairey. They want to be Banksy.
Right. Or, you know, Damien Hirst or somebody, artist. You know?
It's like, guess what? It's too late for that.
But
that
you know what? I mean,
happen anymore. Like the way they did it, it doesn't happen anymore.
No, because the secret's out, because we know how they did it too.
Exactly.
So art is all about the veil too. It's how much can we hide? How much is something worth? Nobody tells you that, right? It's all about the secret and the allure of success that people want you to strive for. ArtShare takes the art off of the pedestal. We put the prices right on the wall. We, you know, put the Instagram page right on the wall of the artist. You could DM them, skip the gallery, and buy it directly from them if you want to be that asshole. Like, we're not here. Nice. You like that little plug. We're not here to prevent an artist from succeeding. But we can also help an artist maybe share their work and see it on a gallery wall and then go, okay, that was enough. That felt good. When I'm 85, I won't regret that I didn't, that I tried it.
Yes.
Thank you to ArtShare, you know, let me put them in my will or something. Like, I think it's more about giving them a running chance and giving them a fighting chance.
That's really interesting, because it's like, you know what? Some people pick up the guitar to impress their friends, right? It's kind of like ArtShare is kind of like, hey, here's a opportunity maybe for you to perform. And you're like, hey, that was great. That's awesome. I did it. And there's some people that want to kind of take it more seriously. And like you said, it's like there's different variations of success as a guitarist, man. So most people think you want to be, you know, the rock star in a band, like, you know what I mean? But studio musicians, like, I'm just saying there's like tons of different ideas of what is quote unquote making it, you know what I mean?
Totally.
And I think that that's like something that it's great that you guys are a resource, because I think especially early, I feel like I've answered a lot of the questions along the journey, actually, whenever you have questions like, oh, how do I do this? You eventually find out how to, after you know, go in the wrong door like 3 times, basically, right? I think ArtShare is pretty cool because at least it gives you some sort of resource to help you out, because I think out of art school, I mean, they just set you out on your own. They said, here you go.
Dude, yeah, they didn't give me any kind of a marketing. I went to Ringling School of Art and Design in Sarasota, Florida, graduated, ended up with a bachelor's degree of fine arts, had to go to a little junior college to get my associate arts and all that stuff, but got a bachelor's degree of fine arts, which doesn't mean a hill of beans to anyone. You know, it looks good if you want to put it on a resume or something like that, but I ended up mainly doing commission paintings. And these people don't care if you got a master's degree.
Yeah.
If what you make, if they don't like it, doesn't matter.
And meanwhile, there's artists who are doing really, really well who are insecure about not having that art degree too. You know what I mean? So it's like, it's so interesting to me. It's
And then there are artists that are doing really, really well who aren't good artists. So go figure that one out.
Right. Like,
how are they making it?
They're good at branding. They're good at timing.
Hustling.
And hustle. It doesn't come without hustle. Yeah. Okay, that's one thing that people need to realize and understand. A lot of people, when the movie Exit Through the Gift Shop came out, and Mr. Brainwash, Terry Guetta, you know, became famous all of a sudden. No, it wasn't all of a sudden. That dude put his time in. That dude was busting ass, trying to sell T-shirts at a T-shirt shop. You know, like that they would get a big pile bulk of clothing and they would take them and they would put them up on nice hangers and he'd tell stories about them and sell them for a lot of money. And then he started doing street art himself, getting up in the streets incessantly, you know, obsessive as an obsessive mind. And then he followed a bunch of street artists around, graffiti artists around, filming them. Like, this guy put in years and years and years of work, and just the people understood how much work it takes.
It does. Then it does. And I think the more you put into it, the more you get out of it, right? Like, James, you were saying you open the door three times and you realize it's a dead end. You still have to open that door three times. Like, even if I told you don't open that door, you're going to do
true.
It.
That's true.
And a lot of artists come to Art Share saying, which door do I open? And we'll tell them the right door. There you go. But then they still have to do the homework.
It wasn't
they
what
still
they imagined,
have to go
basically.
Out and create that. Exactly.
You know,
and so Art Share becomes like a gathering ground so they can meet each other and create their own communities and their own little collaborative groups.
Yeah, and this podcast is fun because we since I'm a musician and teach as an artist, we can share these parallels without letting people, we can help people find parallels without letting, you know, talking about exactly the same scenario. So I always talk about like my DJ shows. It's kind of like, you know, when I was starting off as just a house party DJ, I would always dream about DJing like big venues with like a bunch of people, you know what I mean? And then, you know, the day I actually did that, my first like big venue with a bunch of people and things like that, you know what? It was like one of the worst nights of my life, even though I accomplished one of my goals, because the setup of everything and then having to deal with the security and the venue and all this kind of stuff, although I accomplished my goal. A lot of times when you reach that, what you imagine to be success,
the reality is never as good as
the reality is totally different. You know what I mean? And then you realize you start to question, like, you know, what reasons am I in this for? And I think that's so cool that it's like Art Share is like a resource for you to have. I mean, at the end of the day, it's like you may live in a bunch of live in an apartment with a bunch of introverts, but at least you can commiserate with those people like living inside the Art
which
Share,
by the way, we would right? be interested in interviewing some of them, you know, if any of them would be interested, some of the more crazy ones. We like crazy, you know. Well, what we're trying to do with this podcast is, you know, we wanted to give first, it started off as just like street artists, graffiti artists, but any artist basically that has any kind of concept of street art or has seen it before, or, you know, anything like that, you know, we wanted to give them another platform to get people to know them, you know, and be able to express themselves. And so, you know,
I think all the artists really have right now, visual artists especially, it's like, they have Instagram and it's like, hey, here's my Instagram, pay attention to me, you know what I mean? But it's like so hard to get people like concentrated on you as a person. So we had David Puck on, we've had, you know, a lot of the artists like
Jeremy Novy. Jeremy Novy twice.
You know, Wordsmith, Carr, all those guys that have been on. And what I love about it is because I've seen all their art, you know, on social media, and it makes me like love them even more after I talked to like Jeremy Novy, you know what I mean? We literally had no idea who he was. I just saw his art, and I heard he's SF artist, and he just moved down to LA. I said, let's have him on. And he's like a regular on our show now, and we love it, you know?
And let me also, like, Jeremy has the hustle.
Yeah.
That man knows how to pivot and knows how to move fast. So the minute the shutdown happened, right, you had some people in society who just, like, shut down. Covers over. I need a minute. This is crazy. It's a nightmare. And then you had the other people who were like, okay, what next? Where do I go? How do I make this work? And Jeremy did that. He was painting garages. He was painting backyards. He was doing face masks. He was doing shirts, like whatever he could to keep his art going. It was truly remarkable. And now I follow him on Facebook and I almost think I need to like mute him or something, because he has like 6 posts a day of something he's doing or hustling or, and I'm just,
I love it that every morning he wakes up.
He's flooding you.
I'm enamored, but I'm also super overwhelmed, because what the fuck am I doing? Like, I'm only creating 3 programs today. What's wrong with me?
I love it because, you know what, one of the things I feel like now we have this nice little community that it's like, hey, you know, Jeremy knows us. And now we're kind of like, we're all on the same wavelength, because I think starting off, especially as an artist, for me, still in music, man. It's like, it's hard to find those people that share the same values and work ethic as you, because at the end of the day, you need those people to commiserate with. Yeah. You need somebody to say like, oh, I'm bummed out because this didn't go through. Somebody that can understand, you know? And totally. I think for our podcast, basically, it's awesome because it's like, for me and Teach, there's no competition in terms of opportunities here. He's a street artist, mm-hmm. I'm a DJ, you know what I mean? So it's like, we just basically, it's like we work together to kind of promote this kind of scene, this community that has kind of arose from LA. And like I said, it gets us opportunities to talk to wonderful people who have projects like you.
Thank you.
Yeah, especially once we get the spray paint line up and running.
I know, this sounds amazing. Yeah. I can't wait to hear about this. Wait, can I talk about community really quick with Let's Paint the Town? Because so Let's Paint the Town started with 10 artists at the beginning. So Jeremy and I both kind of reached out to the artists that we love and know are great to work with. And those artists included Car Part, Amy Smith, David Pock, et cetera, Wordsmith. And so we knew that the first week that we went out and painted, which was done illegally without express permission from really anyone, we knew that we needed to have like really good artists that had a brand that had, you know, you could drive by and know it's Wordsmith or Car Part. Like you just knew their work. And it was a direction from me. Make sure you do you. Show yourself on the canvas, because if we're going to ask people to paint without getting the approval process and that whole kind of rigmarole of approving the image, that we needed to go with 10 artists that were well-known and well-established. So that was awesome. And then when we found more walls, those 10 artists were like, oh, no, I'm good. Who else wants to do it? Who else can we give this opportunity to?
I love that. That's our community,
and,
too.
Right? Know? And when the first round of payment went out, three artists said, nope, I don't want to take it, or can I just have the supply money, not the full amount, and can you redistribute it? And even still, with these 10 artists, these 10 core artists, they're still saying, if we sell this artwork or auction it off, how can we take this money and pull it up and divide it evenly, and art share be included in that even split? And just that kind of unselfish mentality is what I've been waiting for from the arts community. It's so enlightening to see this, and that they want some distribution that's democratic. It's been really, really
that's amazing.
Awesome.
That's awesome. Yes. I love to hear that, because you know, like I said, we're literally in the same community. All those artists that you named, they're all, you know, they've all been on our podcast. And how I kind of feel is like, hey, look, at the end, okay, let's talk about the, I want to talk about the paint real quick before we forget.
Yeah, because please.
I'm a chemist. My company actually makes acrylic.
It just keeps going, James. You're freaking me out.
Look, at the end, like you said, artists, we gotta try different, you know, pivots, you know what I mean? Right. So anyways, this chemistry thing, we manufacture acrylic resin, okay? And then we actually supply the acrylic that goes inside like paints like Montana and Montana 94, basically. So we basically started off, Teach and I were like, hey, let's just do our own paint can. We could probably get like better paint and cheaper prices. You know what I mean? So we basically, I already supply these.
Because we already sell them the material. Right?
So it's kind of like, you know, we're working on a few, you know, different suppliers basically right now, but we already have the name. And we got the logo designed by, there's a lot of people.
A true collaboration, my friend. You started off with the original lettering, okay? And then I took your lettering, I added a little bit to it, and then we sent it to Sean Gatlin, and he helped to clean it up. And so it's go spray paint.
You know what I mean?
Upside down, it's OG.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you know, hopefully we can turn that into a nice brand. It's like, hey, you have your Montanas and you have your Go Paint. You know what I mean, right? So, you know,
going to be the same materials, if not better.
Yeah, so, we want to make sure we want to work with you guys to supply you guys with best quality paint too. You know what I mean?
That'd be awesome.
Yeah, and no, I just love this because I think once this whole quarantine is over, I think you know we definitely could probably work together. You know, some more. And what I love you guys is that you guys are showing me artists that I've never seen before, because they're all jumping in on this art share project, doing the boards too. You know, we'd love to have whoever's, you know, working on this project come on the podcast too.
That'd be awesome. Yeah, it's kind of cool. Whenever we do a call for artists on Art Shares pages, we get such a tremendous response. And it doesn't matter if it's, you know, a new can for Angel City beer that they've just created, or if it's a live mural painting at a festival, or if it's Let's Paint the Town. People, there's no shortage of artists in Los Angeles that we can support. And as many as we're going to lose through this pandemic from them leaving Los Angeles, we will retain so many. And hopefully those that stay behind, you know, will be elevated through this process. Yeah. And I should mention, our building was painted by Michael B. Designs, and it's a beautiful design where it's just, you could read on our website some narrative about it, but the design is really about an idea kind of shooting out. There's kind of a central focus of the design on the corner front where my office is. And then from there, the idea kind of shoots out into the sky and is shared with so many people. And I've loved working with Michael for the past 3 years, but our contract's up with him. So we get to repaint the building again.
Ooh, nice.
The building when I came 10 years ago was yellow and like a prison that was just kind of penitentiary. And then we had Inza from England come out and paint a black facade, which we just loved. And that's when I was really at Art Share, really started at Art Share. And then we brought Michael B in. So now I'm hoping to bring a female artist who's from Los Angeles, and the hunt is always on. So anytime we get any submissions, I'm constantly thinking who could fill that space with a new mural.
And so what's the best way to submit the artwork, like email or website? What can you tell the people to how to?
Yeah, so we usually have Google Forms just set up on our website. So if you go to artsharela.org, and in the top left corner, there's an artist button. Drop down, it's usually visual or performing, and decide which one you are in the moment and go there. And then there's a Google form that you can fill out. I don't know how up to date it is right now.
Visual
but
performing right here on the page. And then you can just click on it and then...
Yeah. And if there isn't a form, then you could subscribe. Just put your email in there and we'll make sure that you're a part of the art opportunities emails that we send out twice a month. You could also just email info@artsharela.org, or anytime you connect through the website, it goes directly to me and I'll send it out to the correct staff person. But we're always looking for new artists, always looking for new places to hang your artwork or have you perform. And with the pandemic kind of shifting everything, we're shutting our theater down for 2020, which is a huge, huge devastation, not just financially for us, but also for the many artists that come through our theater. So finding new stages, new outdoor stages is going to be where I'm going to go.
Okay.
Awesome. Awesome.
Yeah.
Just a little sidebar question. What kind of music do you like?
Personally?
Yeah, we usually ask that because, you know, it's kind of like you asked about visual art and then we talk about music as well. So we want to keep it consistent.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm curious.
So, you know, Art Share, we have 30 people that live upstairs. So the type of music that goes in our theater has to be somewhat unraucous. So I've gained a huge appreciation for avant-garde new music. Taking instruments and playing them in unique ways. We've had our piano treated a couple times where artists will come in and hang paper clips on the actual strings coming from the keys. Wow. And it just distorts the sound just enough that it just creates kind of an off-kiltered sound. And then string instruments, if you're playing with a bow, they're now writing music that talks about the color of the sound, so that weight
synesthesia.
You put on this, weight you put on it, lightness or heaviness on the string, and the different sounds that come from that. So that's really fun to explore for me, someone who's not very musically. musically inclined. But right now I'm totally personally on a Fionna Apple kick. That woman her new has album's made amazing. The pandemic tolerable. So.
That's nice.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a beautiful. Yeah,
you guys, if you guys check out Fionna Apple's new album, I mean, I don't think she's dropped anything for 20 years, and she came back with something super creative. So I'm enjoying that album as well.
And it speaks to what's happening right now. Like, find your voice, say it louder. You know,
you're actually the second person on this podcast who's mentioned her album. Bumblebee said he was really enjoying it as well.
Oh, that's cool. Good to know that.
Brilliant minds think alike. You know what I mean?
Next time I see him, I'll be like, Fionna Apple, right?
What's up, Fionna Group? No, I love it, though. You know what? We've pretty much been an hour, though, but I think it's like we kind of got a good idea of what Art Sure LA is all about.
And Cheyenne has to go. She's a busy lady. She has to go too.
And
I'm a pioneering woman, guys. I have places to go.
You know, and us at LA Stray Gallery, we'd love to work with you more. You know, if you ever need a DJ, you got one right here. Okay. Nice. So and then also another street artist, you got one right here too, basically. So you basically. So you know, follow Art Share LA. It's Art_Share_LA on Instagram, right?
That's correct.
Awesome. And then thank you very much for coming on the show. We really appreciate you.
It was a true pleasure, you guys. I've been following you since I realized I stole your name, and I'm a huge fan. And teacher, I actually met you about 5 years ago at Cindy Schwartzstein from Cartwheel Art's gonna kill me, but she helped produce a large gathering of street artists where everybody had booths and installations kind of throughout this warehouse in Hollywood.
Yes. This was at Iron Studios? Or no, different one?
Yeah, that sounds right.
Okay.
I remember but going yeah, there.
Like
I remember
street art fair or something like that, right?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. I met you and I think I flirted with you even though I'm married and you're married. and I think it went right over your head. So we were safe, but I was like, I was impressed with your work and with just how communicative and present you were with everybody who was coming to have you sign something. So it's a pleasure to meet you here.
I look forward to working with you.
For sure. And James, I'll see you in Covina.
Yeah, definitely. No, we'll work together. We'll do some projects and definitely. I look forward to getting to know you better. All right.
Cool. Thank you guys so much.
So to the audience, follow Art_Share_LA on Instagram and leave us a review. Paint the Town Podcast. Follow us at PTTP Show. And check out our new store that Teach opened up, basically. There's a bunch of cool stuff from Teach. And if you're a resident artist, talk to Teach.
You want to get some artwork up on the store?
On the LA Stray
Gallery. One of our resident artists, get in touch with me.
So, thank you guys very much. Love you guys. Take care. Bye.
Peace. Thanks,
Cheyenne. Bye.
And in